In this presentation, I deliberately do not affect the legal side of the issue, only analyze the perspectives of Crimea in the Russian Federation from the position of detached observer. Now, here you can see, I will explain later why I posted this photo, nowadays Prime Minister of Russian Crimea and President of Chechen Republic of Chechnya, Ramzan Kadyrov. Well, first, so what Russia gained, firstly? From the symbolic point of view, even if the comparison made by President Putin of symbolic and historic significance of Crimea for Russian people with the sacredness of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem for Jews, I'm just going by what published in Russia today in different media, and they somehow lost Arabs. But I agree with you, he said Arabs, of course. But I'm going like Russian media for some. So, even if that comparison was quite disproportional, it should be noted that historically there is a great value of Crimea for Russians. For example, as a symbol of Russian victory over Turkey in their historic struggle for influence in the Black Sea region. Crimea used also as a main area of the Crimea War in the 19th century, unsuccessful but heroic for Russia. What else? In the demographic sphere, there is a population of approximately 2 million citizens in Crimea, and it is suggested, in Russia I mean, that at least most of them are loyal to Russia. It must be taken into account that Russia struggled for years with demographic change. An economic sphere. Crimea, known as tourist area, including sea and mountain resorts, in the last years about 6 million tourists visited the peninsula annually. It is also agricultural area known especially for local wine. Finally, in the strategic, from the strategic point of view, historically the control in the Crimea was important for Russia in the strategic means. However, in the means of 21st century, it is not so vital. A fortiori, there is no land access to the peninsula yet, I mean, from Russia. However, Russian leadership still can be proud of return of the full control on the Black Sea Navy base. To summarize the positive perspectives, I mean positive from the point of view of Russian Federation, Putin's plan of Crimea development needs to be mentioned. Shortly after the takeover was completed, large investments in Crimea were announced in Moscow. $1 billion aid was promised immediately by the government, and Russian companies expressed readiness to invest additional $5 billion in various projects in Crimea. It should be noted that this readiness was the result of very competing demand from the Kremlin. Still, no. Anyway, on March 4th, the Prime Minister of Russia, Dmitry Medvedev, signed an order to build a bridge along the Kerch Strait. Here you can see the demo. Aiming to provide a land route from mainland Russia to Crimea that bypassed Ukraine. Upgrade of the local infrastructure was also announced. Well, contrary to everything shown above, there are many reasons for a skeptical view of the prospects of Crimea. Each of these factors deserves careful analysis. One can say it is just a fly in the ointment, but, let's take a closer look, as you can see. So let's start with the difficulties. The factor of local leadership. When Russia ensured the independence of South Ossetia and Abkhazia from Georgia in 2008, both republics were headed by the representatives of local high elites. Edward Kokoyt of South Ossetia was in charge since 2001. Sergei Bagapsh of Abkhazia was in charge since 2005. They were experienced local leaders. On the contrary, the leader of the separatist movement of Crimea, Sergei Aksyonov, entered the local politics only in 2010. Moreover, his political movement, the Russian Unity, received only 4% in Crimea in the 2012 elections. So, only the intervention of Russian troops allowed him to become the chairman of the Crimean Republic Council of Ministers. Even if we assume that the recent events gave Aksionov legitimacy in the eyes of the citizens of Crimea, it is hard to believe that such a sharp change of elite can occur in a constructive atmosphere. In fact, there are many evidences of aggressive redistribution of property nowadays in Crimea. But there is something even more important about the local leadership factor. I call it the tendency to Kadyrovization. Ramzan Kadyrov, the president of the Republic of Chechnya, on your left, is probably one of the most loyal to Vladimir Putin politicians in Russia. However, this loyalty cost a lot for Moscow. Kadyrov used the Putin's promise to restore order and to rebuild Chechnya after the second Chechen, after both Chechen wars, to receive not only the abnormal subsidies from the federal budget, but also practical sovereignty, legal and financial autonomy. I mean what you do with the money that you receive from the budget. There are many parallels between the Republic of Chechnya in 2000 and the Republic of Crimea in 2014. Both subjects are very symbolic for Russia, and the president's promise to rebuild, to rearrange them is essential in the same way. In both cases, the raising of the local citizens' standard of living must prove moral rightness of Russia. It looks like Aksionov is well aware of it. And not surprisingly, Grozny, the capital of Chechnya, was the first place to visit for his visit after the end of the crisis on June 14th. On September 1st, he published imposing article on the website of official newspaper Rossiyskaya Gazeta, offering to give the Crimean Peninsula the status of a special economic zone. In the article, Aksionov mentioned also the updated level of expected straight governmental investment in Crimea, 658 billion of rubles, about $11 billion. Now, here we come to the economic factor. It should be noted that the rebuilding of Chechnya took place during the best years of Russian economy. There weren't any such sanctions. Oil barrel cost about $100 and not $60-$62 like today. And the people of Russia felt very well the improvement in their living standard. Today, the situation is completely reversed. The Russian economy, hard hit by the worldwide economic crisis of 2008, today suffers also from international sanctions and the drop of oil wages. Russia today is in the midst of federal budget cuts, and it will be quite difficult to find the required amount for Crimea. The conflict with the West leads to a situation when the Western banks and all main banks of Russia closed their branches in Crimea in order to not fall under sanctions. It is extremely difficult to develop a tourist region in absence of international banking in infrastructure. In 2014, the number of tourists visited Crimea halved. 3 million tourists were counted, most of them Russians. While in the last year, there were twice more, about 6 million tourists, and most of them were Ukrainian. If the number of tourists will not increase in the next year, or even worse, the decline will continue, the income of approximately 90% of the Crimean citizens will be in danger. It is also important to remind the main competitor of Crimea in the sphere of tourism, Sochi, the city of the last Winter Olympics. During 2014, Sochi was visited by approximately 5 million tourists from all around the world. However, most of them came to see the Olympic Games. Now, as much as I know, in the next years, Sochi must host no less than 7 million tourists annually to maintain budget balance. considering that next year we haven't Olympics, and taking into account tensions with the West and some deterioration in income of Russians, one can assume that the perspectives of Sochi are also unclear. It should be noted that for Russian leadership, the success of Sochi is important no less than the success of Crimea. They have to justify the enormous costs of development of Olympic infrastructure to their citizens. Thereby, the difficulty of Crimea development is doubled. The overall economic problems, combined with the need to direct the flow of tourists from Russia, mainly from Russia, to the both resorts. Summarizing both factors, the problems with local leadership and its aspirations, the common economic and geopolitical challenges of Russia, and the natural competition of Crimea with another Russian resort in times of crisis, I'm forced to conclude that the socio-economical perspectives of Crimea region not encouraging, to put it mildly. There are many claims in Russia of expected investments to Crimea from China and India in the development of projects in the peninsula, despite the threat of Western sanctions. Well, the confirmation or the refutation of these expectations may teach us a lot about the effectiveness of Russian diplomacy and foreign policy, and even to identify the true nature of the modern system of international relations. Thank you very much for attention.